At this moment, I want to introduce our guest speaker for today, or he's not necessarily a guest speaker. This is his church home. His name is Jeff Perry. Look at this guy. Can we all give Jeff a round of applause, please? You may know Jeff. For those of you who don't know Jeff, Jeff is honestly one of the most pure souls you'll ever meet in your life. Jeff will make you laugh. Jeff will allow you to understand that he is a loving person. Jeff, the first time that we hung out, we were paddleboarding, and we got to walk like 2 or 3 hours on the beach, and we were just talking, just boom, 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 boom. And the fact that there was no awkward moment the entire time really showed me that Jeff really, really loves the Lord. Him and his wife, Ashley, are very active in the church. They both love Jesus. And Jeff today has the opportunity and the privilege to be able to share God's word to you. So everyone, please welcome my friend, Jeff Perry.
Good morning, church. Happy Sabbath.
What a beautiful church we have, don't we?
I mean, the amount of love that pours out in this church is unbelievable. Between a baptism, a baby dedication, and Larry's beautiful prayer. Thank you. So before we begin, I'd like you to call someone up that you may or may not know in the church. He's a good friend of mine, and he is going to have an opening prayer with us. Richie Baltazar. God has blessed this individual with an unbelievable talent to pray, as you will soon see.
Alpha and Omega, the Father of Spirits, the Father of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the Lord of the Sabbath, we come before you right now just as we are, because your word declares from new moon to new moon, from Sabbath to Sabbath, all flesh shall come and worship you. So right now, Father God, we worship you in spirit and in truth. We pray, Father God, that your Holy Spirit would descend with power and with might inside of this sanctuary right now to heal, to cleanse, to purify, and to cast out any kind of spirit of fear, dumbness, autism, and negativity. And I pray, oh Lord, that you will cleanse each and every person, Father God, in the Fort Myers Seventh-day Adventist Church. And I pray, Father God, that you will lay your hands on them. Amen. And I pray, Father God, that you will be with Jeff at this second. Allow, Father God, his words to be influenced by your Holy Spirit. For your word declares that it is not by might nor by power, but it is by your Holy Spirit. Be with us, Father God. Help us fix our eyes on you. And I pray that you will kidnap each and every person's mindsets, Father God, inside of this sanctuary so they can be focused, Father God, on what you have to say. And I pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah.
Amen. Thank you, Richie. It's powerful, isn't he? All right, folks. I want to open up and explain to you that this presentation would not be able to be done without Dr. William West. We're going to dedicate this to him. He was a church friend, a member, a beloved student of God's Word. As many of you who knew Dr. West, he had studied many different topics, but one of his favorite topics to study was total surrender. And you know, with special thanks to Helen, she was able to provide me with his Bible and his notebook and material, so a lot of the information is coming straight from Dr. West. I'd like to start out with a short personal story. In 2018, I'd been married for 4 years. Things were going great. God had really blessed us. We had a new home, and we started a new family of four-legged children. We were enjoying lots of traveling, and things were going really well. You know, as a married man, I had taken a vow to protect and care for my wife. I was strong, I was confident, and I could solve problems. And for the most part, I did. But you see, God had something to teach me. One day, my wife started to complain about some numbness on the left side of her face. We initially dismissed it and thought maybe she slept on it wrong. After all, she was 33 years old and was beautiful and had wonderful medical history. A few days went by. We decided we really need to get this checked out. And unfortunately, we received the terrible news that she had a mass growing inside of her brain, which was causing the problems. She immediately was rushed to University of Miami Hospital and seen by some of the best brain surgeons in the United States. As the doctors explained, the mass had to come out, except the problem was it was in a very difficult place to remove. You see, doctors were hesitant to perform the surgery due to the potential complications or even death. It was at this point that I realized in a hallway in University of Miami Hospital that I had no power to control the situation. I was in complete terror. I had to learn to totally surrender to God. In that moment of total surrender, I had a peace in the middle of the worst storm of my life. You see, it was a long journey. There were many ups and downs. But being totally surrendered to Christ on a daily basis and through the prayers and support of our family and the faithful members of this church, we got through it. And fast forward to today, the surgery was a success, and my wife appears as bright and beautiful as she always has been. Amen. Well, when I began to study the idea of total surrender, I came to realize there's two types of total surrender. There's total surrender in time of need, and total surrender to God's will. I find these two verses to be extremely helpful to understand total surrender in time of need. The first is 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. Give all your worries and cares to God, for he cares about what happens to you. And another verse that I really enjoy is Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. And I certainly experience grace. What about the Bible? Where can we find some examples of total surrender in time of need? Well, there are many, actually. But one that stood out to me is the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You see, there were three Jewish boys that were first forced to work under the Babylonian king, Nebuchadnezzar. One day, he called everyone out to an open field, and he ordered them, at the sound of the musical instruments, to bow down and worship false gods and a gold statue. Well, the boys refused. They remained standing. You see, this infuriated the king. He gave them one more chance, and he told them they'd be thrown into a fiery furnace if they refused to bow down. And the boys did something that shocked everyone. You see, these boys decided to totally surrender to God. And in Daniel chapter 3, verse 17 through 18, this is what they said. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God whom we serve is able to save us. He will rescue us from your power. But even if he doesn't, we want to make clear to you that we will never serve your gods or worship the gold statue you've set up. Well, the king became furious with rage, and he demanded the fire be heated seven times hotter. And he ordered Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to be bound and thrown into the fire. The king looked into the fire. He saw not three, but four men walking around, untouched by the flames. And the fourth person appeared to be divine. The king ordered the men out of the fire. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego walked out without a scratch, and the Bible says they didn't even smell like smoke. What a beautiful example of faith and total surrender to God in time of need. You know, we may never face a fiery furnace, but we sure to have troubles in times of need. You know, total surrender is not weakness. It's drawing on God's power to get through difficult situations. Let us take a look now at total surrender to God's will. James 4:10 reads, When you bow down before the Lord and admit your dependence on him, he will lift you up and give you honor. And as we heard in the opening prayer, which is a beautiful verse from Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. These are great Bible verses to remember relating to total surrender to God's will. And now I want to share with you a story about a couple named Kathy and John. You see, this was a young Adventist couple that decided to move to rural Tennessee. They wanted to start their family, and it was kind of their dream to live there. They had a 7-year-old daughter named Emma, and life was really starting to go well for them. You know, they had bought the land, they built their home, John had received a decent job and a salary. They really felt like life was going well for them. But you know, deep in their hearts, they always had this doubt, this question that was pressing on them. And it was, could they do more to serve? You see, John's father was a retired pastor, so they always wondered, should John have gone into ministry? Should he be a pastor as well? So they researched it, they talked about it. They realized there was a ministry school from the Amazing Facts in California. When they researched it, they realized, well, it was quite a bit of money, and they would have to relocate, and how would John find work out in California? And just all things seemed way too complicated, and they couldn't figure it out, so they continued living life. Well, one evening, their daughter Emma became really ill. Kathy rushed her to the hospital, and doctors, amazingly, could not figure out what was wrong with Emma. Kathy was distraught. She laid beside her in her hospital bed, crying out to God. She says she feels as though she was Abraham, sacrificing her only child. It was at that moment that she cried out to God and asked God for help in the situation, and she felt in her heart that God said, just trust me, surrender to me, and I will see you through. Shortly after, there was just complete silence, and the doctors walked in with the great news that they had medication for their daughter. The medication was administered, and Emma recovered, and she's healthy and normal as a young lady today. Kathy and John went back to church. They shared their testimony of how God worked to save their daughter with the rest of the congregation. Several weeks later, one of the elders approached Kathy and said, we have a church member who is dying and has personally requested that you go to her house to help her make funeral arrangements. Kathy was shocked. She barely knew this lady. After all, they had just moved to Tennessee and started going to this church. But as a child of God, she said, of course, I'll go. So she drove out to this rural countryside mountain house that looked a lot like this one here. It was very run down, no running water, barely electricity. She went inside and she met Miss Anita. Miss Anita explained to her that she was dying, and she asked Kathy to help her with her final arrangements. Over the course of a couple of days, she directed Kathy to go to various places in the house where she had hidden these envelopes. Kathy did as she asked, collected the envelopes. Miss Anita said, could you please give the envelopes to the pastor to hold on to? Kathy did so. Well, several days later, Miss Anita was admitted to the hospital. And Kathy and the pastor had visited Miss Anita, and as they were standing by her bedside, Miss Anita reached out her hand and held Kathy's hand. She said these words, I saw the faith that you and your husband had when your only daughter was dying. I want you to have the money I've collected. God is calling you into ministry. Kathy was in complete shock. Here she was, standing next to almost a complete stranger. And having never shared their idea with Miss Anita that God was calling John into the ministry, she knew that this was absolutely God's will. Well, fast forward to today, and John has graduated from the Amazing Facts ministry, and he is now serving as a pastor at the Granite Bay Church alongside Pastor Doug Batchelor. And Kathy works for Amazing Facts as well in California. And you know, the amazing part of the story is that once Kathy was willing to totally surrender to God in the hospital, he was able to use her to share her testimony with the church, which then led Miss Alita to totally surrender her life savings, which, by the way, was $25,000. And that enabled John to receive the training and the position as a pastor to then lead many people to Christ. Kathy summarizes the story in this way, which is amazing. I long for the day in heaven to see Miss Anita again, to introduce her to all the people she helped save. You see, when God calls us, it may require a tremendous leap of faith. We can't imagine the things that he has in store. We fear the unknown, especially when the end is uncertain. But we don't have to know the results before we begin, if we trust in God. Amen. One of my favorite clever sayings is, man says, show me and I'll believe. But God says, believe me and I will show you. We must be strong and courageous, trusting in him and act in faith. But isn't it interesting, the noble ideas that we come up with on how to serve God or how to please him? You know, we have to be careful and examine those ideas and be sure they don't contradict his word. For if they do, we are actually being disobedient to God. The truth is, God isn't impressed by our ideas. What he's impressed by is our obedience to him. In fact, the Bible says he delights in it. So we must continually examine our motives and what we do for God. We must stop and ask the question, are our acts of service out of obedience to God's will, or are they a way to fulfill our desires? John Quincy Adams was a sixth president of the United States. There's an interesting story about him that very few people ever talk about. You see, after his presidential term, he did what no other or future president has ever done. He ran for a seat in the House of Representatives. This was a tremendously humbling act after serving as president of the United States. You see, it was because he felt a calling to God, from God, to serve, and he fought diligently against slavery and the rights for people. But you know, after many attempts to change laws, he obtained very few victories, but he never stopped trying. When he was asked why he didn't quit after being so unsuccessful, he responded with this beautiful quote, "The duty is mine, the results are the Lord's." What a wonderful, humble example of total surrender to God's will. You see, we must listen to that still, small voice in our heart, the voice of God through the Holy Spirit is calling us to totally surrender and do his will. You know, the beauty of it is, God is calling me and he's calling you to total surrender. But you may say, well, what if the Holy Spirit hasn't spoken to me? Well, I believe the more we love God and show our love for him through obedience, through prayer, and through studying his word, the more direction we get from him. So ask yourself this question, have I shown a willingness to surrender? Dr. West wrote this quote, "Absent total surrender to God, Satan and self always fill the void." Well, how about surrendering to what we know God wants all of us to do? You see, when Jesus was asked, what's the greatest commandment to follow? He replied in Matthew 22:37, "You must love the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind, and a second equally important, love your neighbor as yourself." You know, this is the golden rule, right? We've heard it before. And it's not a difficult concept to understand. Even the animal kingdom understands this concept. Here's a cute story about two goats. You see, two goats were traveling in opposite directions on a mountain trail. One was climbing up the mountain, the other was climbing down. The two came head to head, and they couldn't go any further. When they saw each other, they backed up, they lowered their heads as though they were ready to lunge. But then a wonderful thing happened. The goat going uphill decided to lay down on the trail. The goat going downhill just simply stepped over his back, continued down the mountain. Once he was by, the goat going uphill stood up and continued to climb the mountain. You see, if we totally surrender, we'll automatically love and serve one another. Folks, we must prepare to surrender and serve. Much like our Savior came into the world to serve, we must transform ourselves to be more like him. Amen. We need to stop and remove our selfish desires. We need to totally surrender. On September 29th in 2017, Dr. West noted the following powerful statements written by Ellen White in the matter of total surrender. The first, the only way to make real Christ's promise of victory over self and sin is by total surrender to him. Amen. Second, if we are not totally surrendered, we will be lost. Third, absent total surrender to God, we serve the powers of darkness. And fourth, and most powerful, through total surrender to God, we become impregnable to the assaults of Satan. Amen. You see, surrender is not weakness. When we surrender, we team up with God. Who better to team up with than the power that has the ability to call legions of angels down to earth? Sister White provided us with a beautiful description about surrender from the Book of Education on page 57. A noble character is the result of self-discipline, the subjection of the lower to the higher nature, the surrender of self for the service of love to God and man. Amen. Lastly, there is no greater story in history of total surrender than of Jesus, found in Matthew 26. You see, Jesus knew his time was nearing the end. And he took his apostles to an olive grove called Gethsemane. He went off into the night and began to pray to his Father in heaven. As he prayed, his soul was crushed with grief. The pain was so overwhelming, he fell face down to the ground, and he cried out, saying, "Oh, my Father, if it be possible, let this cup of suffering pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt." Jesus knew that he would endure the pain and suffering of bearing the sins of the world. But still, through it all, he totally surrendered to God as if it was his will. Through his surrender to God, you and I now have the promise of peace in eternity in heaven, with no more pain and no more sorrow. In closing, we must remember the things of this life are temporary. Popularity, status, wealth, and so on. But you see, our relationship with God is eternal. Amen. So the question is, are you ready and willing to totally surrender to God's will? Amen. If you are able, let's take this moment to kneel and pray silently to God. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this Sabbath day. We thank you that you've helped each person here in a time of need. And we pray that you continue to be there as we surrender to you. Lord, I ask that you help each person to totally surrender to your will in their life. And we thank you, Lord, and we give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.